Learning medicine is hard work. Osmosis makes it easy. It takes your lectures and notes to create a personalized study plan with exclusive videos, practice questions, and flashcards, and so much more. Try it free today.
Neisseria meningitidis, also called N. meningitidis, or just meningococcus, is a gram-negative round bacterium that causes meningitis in humans, as well as life-threatening conditions like sepsis and disseminated intravascular coagulation. Now, N. meningitidis has a thin peptidoglycan layer, so it doesn't retain the crystal violet dye during gram staining. Instead, like any other gram-negative bacteria, it stains pink with safranin dye. N. meningitidis typically live in pairs called diplococci, stacked side to side so the pair looks kind of like a coffee bean. They're also non-motile, non-spore-forming, and obligate aerobes, which means they absolutely need oxygen to grow. Finally, they're catalase and oxidase positive, which means they produce both these enzymes. N. meningitidis grows on a special chocolate medium called Thayer-Martin agar, which mainly consists of sheep's blood. Yum? Some antimicrobials, like vancomycin and niastatin, are usually added to the Thayer-Martin agar to inhibit the possible growth of undesired bacteria or fungi, and maximize the growth of Neisseria species. However, other Neisseria species, like N. gonorrheae, also share these properties. So the maltose fermentation test is done to differentiate the two. The gist of it is that N. meningitidis can ferment maltose, whereas N. gonorrheae cannot. To check for this, a pure sample from the culture is transferred to a sterile tube containing a mix of phenol red and maltose, which is then incubated at 36 degrees Celsius for 24 hours. N. meningitidis causes acidic fermentation of maltose, and the resulting byproducts make the solution turn yellow. With N. gonorrheae, the solution stays red. Now, N. meningitidis has a number of virulence factors that are like assault weaponry that help it attack and destroy the host cells and evade the immune system. First, N. meningitidis is encapsulated, meaning it's covered by a polysaccharide layer called a capsule. The capsule has pili, which are hair-like extensions that help the bacteria attach to host cells. Underneath the capsule, there's the outer cell membrane, which has two opacity proteins, called OPA and OPC, and they also help N. meningitidis attach to host cells. Additionally, N. meningitidis produces toxins, and the most important one is IgA protease, a toxic protein that this bacterium uses to destroy immunoglobulin A, or IgA. IgA is an immune system protein found in the nasopharyngeal mucosa secretions that normally opsonizes invading bacteria, meaning it tags them so neutrophils can recognize and destroy them. So IgA protease neutralizes the first line of mucosal defense. However, not all IgA molecules get neutralized. So some N. meningitidis bacteria are still opsonized, and they get attacked by neutrophils. Within a neutrophil, N. meningitidis gets wrapped in a phagosome, which is like a bubble inside which reactive oxygen species, such as hydrogen peroxide, are released to kill it. However, N. meningitidis releases catalase, which breaks down hydrogen peroxide. Unfortunately, this translates as a win for the bacteria, which now takes over the neutrophil and uses its energetic resources to multiply. The neutrophil eventually becomes too full, bursting open and releasing N. meningitidis into the bloodstream, which is known as meningococcemia. Inside the bloodstream, N. meningitidis uses another toxin called factor H binding protein, which disables factor H, a protein involved in the alternate complement pathway, which plays a role in antibacterial immunity. This allows N. meningitidis to spread, multiply, and produce toxins in the bloodstream, causing destruction of the capillary endothelial cells, which results in leaky capillaries. N. meningitidis also has a cell wall antigen called lipooligosaccharide, or LOS, which can trigger a widespread immune reaction that results in sepsis, meaning blood vessels dilate so blood pressure drops and vital organs don't get enough blood. Yikes. Finally, meningococcal sepsis can lead to disseminated intravascular coagulation, or DIC. That's because the damaged endothelial cells release procoagulant-like tissue factor, which makes clots form inside the blood vessels, and that depletes platelets and clotting factors. Unfortunately, this leads to severe bleeding throughout the body. If a lot of blood pools within the adrenal gland, local pressure increases, which makes the adrenal blood vessels pinch shut. This results in ischemia and eventually necrosis of the various hormone-producing cells in the adrenal gland, a condition known as Waterhouse-Friedrichsen syndrome. Insufficient production of adrenal hormones, especially aldosterone and cortisol, can further worsen the shock. Now, the good news is that meningococcus can actually colonize the nasal and pharyngeal mucosa of many people, where it doesn't do any harm so long as the immune system keeps them in check, restricting their growth and preventing them from getting into the bloodstream. Problems arise in individuals with weaker immune systems, like infants and the elderly. Other immune-weakening conditions include an HIV infection, diabetes, malignancy, or alcohol abuse. Additionally, since the spleen plays an important role in immunity against encapsulated bacteria, meningitis infections are more common in people who have had a splenectomy, meaning their spleen was surgically removed, or in those with sickle cell disease who have functional asplenia. Most commonly, meningococcemia results in meningitis. Meningitis is actually the only bacteria known to cause meningitis epidemically, most likely in people living in close quarters, like soldiers in a camp, or among larger communities that share the same source of fresh water. Meningitis happens when the bacteria move within the bloodstream up to the brain, and use its toxins to break through the endothelial cells that make up the blood-brain barrier. This way, it gets into the cerebrospinal fluid, or CSF, resulting in meningitis. People with meningitis typically present with headache, fever, and neck stiffness. Symptoms of meningococcemia include a petechial rash, which are small red or purple spots that often appear on the trunk and lower extremities. And with sepsis, there may be signs of shock, like hypotension and tachycardia. Diagnosis requires blood cultures to look for meningitis in the blood, as well as a lumbar puncture for CSF analysis and culture. Treatment relies on prompt administration of ceftriaxone. Following the results of an antibiogram, treatment can be switched to penicillin G. Additionally, prophylactic ceftriaxone, rifampin, or ciprofloxacin should be given to close contacts of the affected individual. Finally, it is recommended that people who are at risk of a meningococcal infection get vaccinated, and these include babies, children and teens, adults with spleen issues, or those who travel in places where meningitis is endemic. Currently, there's two kinds of vaccines against meningitis. One is the meningococcal conjugate vaccine, typically given to children and teens. The other is the meningococcal recombinant vaccine, and it's the one typically given to adults. All right, as a quick recap, Neisseria meningitis is a gram-negative diplococcus that grows on Thayer-Martin agar. It is non-motile, non-spore-forming, oxidase-positive, catalase-positive, and it can ferment maltose. Its virulence factors include the capsule, the pili, and proteins like OPA, OPC, IgA protease, and LOS. Meningococcemia mainly causes meningitis, but it can also result in other severe conditions such as sepsis, disseminated intravascular coagulation, and Waterhouse-Friedrichsen syndrome. Treatment with intravenous ceftriaxone is rapidly started upon clinical suspicion, but the treatment can be adjusted afterwards as soon as the CSF culture and antibiogram are available.
Thanks for watching. If you're interested in a deeper dive on this topic, take a look at osmosis.org, where we have flashcards, questions, and other awesome tools to help you learn medicine. Otherwise, you can always support us by donating on Patreon, subscribing to our channel, or following us on social media.